we strut and fret our hour upon the stage, and then are heard no more. So how long is an hour? To Shakespeare, a lifetime was an hour. To some people, an hour is a lifetime.
Well, I'm sure this hour won't seem like a lifetime. I'm Robert W. Morgan. This week, on the special of the week, we'll have the time of our lives with a man who's become a legend in his own time by staying ahead of the times. In fact, time is the essence of his music. There's the past with its memories ignited by a song on the radio, the present in Casablanca during the Year of the Cat, and the future, which can be entered only through time passages. Time waits for no man, but it stops for Al Stewart.
It was late in December, the sky turned to snow. All around the day was going down slow. Night like a river beginning to flow. I felt the beat of my mind go drifting into time passages. Years go falling in the fading light. Time passages. Buy me a ticket on the last train home tonight.
I'm always, for a start, living in several different time zones, you know. I don't think I ever get through a whole day in the year that I'm in. I mean, I could walk out of here and go down the street and it could very easily be 1962 again, you know what I mean?
Come on, baby! Let's do that twist. Come on, baby!
I mean, the world just disappears and it's 1962 in my head.
If for only a moment you felt you were back in 1962, then you know how Al Stewart's music works.
Time runs through your face. You never hold it at all till it's gone. Sun fragments just linger with you like snow in the spring hanging on.
As the world's only amateur historian whose research you can dance to, Al believes there's no time like the present, even if the present happened long ago. What does this mean? Well, I'm not exactly sure either, but the answer seems to lie in Al Stewart's hobby, wine.
Wine is a drink of lovers. It's really sophisticated. It really is a complex thing that you can learn. It's a great challenge. You know? It's very stimulating to the brain to really just sit down and think about wine. I like it in the same way as I like history, because to me they're intertwined. If I were to drink, which I wouldn't, to 63, because it's absolutely horrible, then I would be back with the Beatles and John F. Kennedy and whatever. I mean, you drink wine from any period, like you drink a 1957 or something, and you're there with singing the blues and early Elvis Presley, and you really have to think how the people lived at the time that the wine was produced, how the world was. I can be transported back into different periods of history by tasting wine from different periods.
It seems to me as though I've been upon the stage before and juggled away the night for the simple crowd. These harlequins you see with me, they too upheld the floor. As here once again they strutted me, but they're out. I see those half familiar faces in the second row. Ghost-like, with the footlights and their eyes. But where or when we met like this last time, I just don't know. It's like a chord that rings and never dies.
Al Stewart is so obsessed by time, he even has a see-through wristwatch, apparently so he can gaze at the mechanism inside and watch time fly.
Yes, I do. This is true. me and Salvador Dali. He likes wine, too. He wrote a whole book on wine. But anyway, that's straying off the point.
If this is all beginning to sound like a lot of nonsense to you, well, that's the point. Long before Al ever wrote about Basque nationalism or Bogart movies, he composed nonsense poetry.
Oh, yes. In fact, you want to hear a nonsense poem I wrote when I was 13? Okay, so if I can remember it. From the flickering eastern shores to the prison's bolted doors, every man and child alive, be he 3 or 95, has at some time in his life, with his mother, son, or wife, seen a flicker on the moon and thought, what on earth's a poon? It goes on, it's to describe a poon. A poon is a circular creature which has no arms or legs, you know, and just floats in midair. And they're usually satellites of geeks. Jupiter has moons and geeks have poons. Are you following any of this?
Said the apple to the orange, oh, I wanted you to come close to me and kiss me to the core. Then you might know me like no other orange has ever done before.
I think Henry James's definition of a writer is someone who hates writing and the discipline of having to sit down and actually construct sensible words or reasonably sensible words is just so much hard work that I leave it to the last possible moment.
Although most of Al Stewart's songs are about the past, he waits until it's almost the future before he writes them. In fact, he doesn't begin writing the lyrics to a song until well after the music's been recorded. Even then, Al has no idea what the song's going to be about.
Not at all. Not at all. Very often I write two or three different sets of lyrics and pick the best one. Year of the Cat's a perfect example of that. It wasn't Year of the Cat. I had the backing track for about a year, and it was various things during that year. At one time it was called Foot of the Stage, and it was about a British comedian called Tony Hancock. And ultimately, in the end, it was Year of the Cat from the Casablanca movie.
Strolling through the crowd like Pete DeLorean contemplating a crime. She comes out of the sun in a silk dress, running like a watercolor in the rain. Don't bother asking for explanation, she'll just tell you that she came in the year of the cat. Give you time for questions as she locks up your arm in hers, and you follow till your sense of which direction completely disappears. By the blue-tiled walls near the market stalls, there's a hidden door she leads you to. These days she says, I feel my life just like a river running through the year of the cat. While she looks at you so coolly, and her eyes shine like the moon in the sea, she comes in incense and patchouli. So you take her to find what's waiting inside the year of the cat.
I'm the bus and the tourists are gone, and you've thrown away your choice and lost your ticket, so you have to stay on. But the drumbeat strains of the night remain, and the rhythm of the new fontaine. You know, sometime you're bound to leave her, but for now you're gonna stay. In the year of the cat, year of the cat.
Stewart runs off to Zanzibar to study the bugle. Let's hope he'll be back in time to join us when we continue on the special of the week. I'm Robert W. Morgan. Robert W. Morgan on the special of the week with Al Stewart.
I was going to tell you that I'd studied the bugle at the Zanzibar Institute. If you asked me where I started today, I was thinking when I came along in the car that it would have been wonderful to have studied the bugle, because the bugle is such a totally ridiculous instrument, and just that you could actually spend time studying bugle playing, you know, it's, that seemed to me just fantastic. So I was going to say that to you, but you didn't ask, so I've said it anyway.
Well, I'm up to my neck in crumbling wreckage of all that I wanted from life. When I looked for respect, all I got was neglect, though I swallowed the line as a sign of the time. But dealing the jack from the back of the pack, they said, you lose again.
Al Stewart was born a world away from Zanzibar in Glasgow, Scotland.
I'm not really from Glasgow. I just happened to be born there. I grew up the first 3 years of my life in Greenock, about which I remember almost nothing. But then we went to Stratford-on-Avon. I very rarely go back and visit those kind of places because certain time zones hold more fascination for me than others. And growing up, certainly as a child, was not very much fun. I didn't like being a child at all. Some people do very well at being children, and I was not one of them. I was always a loner.
While traveling northwards on a backcountry lane, I came on the village where first I grew, and stopped to climb up the hill once again, looking down from the tracks to the grey slate roofs. I watched the village moving as the day went slowly by. In the fields we lay here, my very first love and I, under timeless Arcadian skies, under timeless Arcadian skies.
I didn't do anything that children are supposed to do well. You know, I was no good at kicking footballs around and that kind of thing.
What Al Stewart was good at, however, was kicking the language around, thanks to his nonsense poetry and playing the guitar. Unfortunately, his boarding school teachers righteously believed the only thing more disgraceful than nonsense poetry was the guitar.
They said it was an immoral instrument, so I had to keep it in the left luggage office of the local railway station, and I had to go out and play it. I had to break out of bounds, and it cost me, I think, sixpence a week or something to keep it there. And I would play it in the field behind the railway station in the afternoons and then go back to school again. My headmaster thought, correctly actually, that the guitar would lead to me not living the sort of life which befitted someone coming from his school. So he banned it.
When we came to the station, all the trains were rusty. The doors were open and the windows broken in. There was grass and all the cracks and the air hung musty. Travel posters were flapping in the wind. So I walked through the dust and gloom, playing waiting games in the waiting room. Lay our sleeping bags out on the floor. And on Sunday morning, Easy Rider comes to me with apple cider. Leave me here without a place to go.
The guitar may very well be an immoral instrument, not befitting a boy from one of Britain's best boarding schools. But it was a guitar that enabled Al Stewart to meet the Beatles.
It was great because there were, like, you know, 500 screaming kids outside the hotel, and we managed to work our way in. Don't ask me how. I think I was 17 or something at the time, and I think I said I was a representative of Rickenbacker Guitars who'd come down specially from London to talk to John Lennon about his guitar, and actually it worked. I got in, and I actually met John Lennon, and I actually played that old black Rickenbacker. I don't know how. I didn't tell him that. I think I just said, I want to see your Rickenbacker Whacker or something like that, and he went out and he got it.
Do you remember the changes as we grew? Slowly, slowly, slow. Sneaking in the back way into movies after school for the evening show. Chasing skinny blue jean girls across the building site. Checking out the dance floor while the band played Hold Me Tight. See the blonde one over there, I bet she'd be alright. It all comes back like yesterday. It almost seems like yesterday.
I wanted to hitchhike to Paris and meet Jean-Paul Sartre when I was 18, very much indeed, right? Because I thought there would be some kind of an amazing communication, and he would look to me and he would tell me the secret of great literature or of life or of political philosophy or whatever. And I did actually hitchhike to Paris, but then I got malnutrition and had to have my parents ship me back again. I decided I would stop the first Frenchman and ask him what freedom is, you know. So I said, what is liberté? And he looked at me and he said, liberté, c'est boire, and walked off, you know, which just means freedom is drinking. That seemed pretty good.
Ghost of revolution still prowls the Paris streets. Down all the restless centuries, it wanders incomplete. It speaks inside the cheap red wine of cafes on the night. It's red and amber voices call the cars at traffic lights. Why do you wait to see the day begin? Your time is wasting in the wind. Wondering why, wondering why it echoes through the lonely palace.
It just seemed like all my life I'd been in the wrong place at the wrong time. And all of a sudden, I knew I was in the right place at the right time.
The right time was the mid-60s, and the right place was Soho, London's version of New York's Greenwich Village, a neighborhood filled with starving artists and struggling musicians. Al liked the place so much, he wrote a song about it.
The first line of that song is one of my best lines. That's a good line. Rainstorm, brainstorm, faces in the maelstrom, huddled by the puddles in the shadows where the drains run. That's really W.H. Auden.
Rainstorm, brainstorm,
faces in the maelstrom, huddled by the kettles in the shadows where the dreams run. Hot dogs, wet dogs, flicking up the sidewalk, disappearing into the blue shop. Rainbow cues done down by the newsstand, waiting for the late show. Pinball, cinema, minds in free fall. Chocolate-colored ladies making eyes through the smoke ball. Soho, needless to say, I'm alone on your streets on a Friday evening. I've been here all of the day. I'm going nowhere with nowhere to go.
Soho, needless to say, was sort of like being back in boarding school for Al. Except now he didn't have to sneak off to play his guitar.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, nobody's learning from me because I just kind of left school and come to London with an acoustic guitar, and I was just kind of very wide-eyed. Then I moved into this apartment, and Paul Simon walked through the door one day and stayed for 4 months, you know, and it was fascinating. I was there listening to him write Homeward Bound. He was in his room. I was just outside, and I kept hearing... and then a bit of pause and you hear railway station. That was really interesting first hand to see someone do that, because I mean at that point in time I was just singing Masters of War every night and the times they were changing. Paul wrote this incredible skit called The Songs They Were Changing, and one line was come singer-songwriters throughout the land and don't criticize what you can't understand. But there were really different things happening.
Sometimes it seems unimaginable that you were ever any other way. With your white rose face and your orphan clothes, embroidered jeans and silver chains. You're a well-known face in all the hangout places where the lost souls congregate. You sit all night but you talk too fast. I don't know what you're trying to say. Oh, Carol, I think it's time for running for cover. Believe me, you're everyone's and nobody's lover. You got a one-way ticket for all your yesterdays. I know your daddy said he'd talk to you, but he never really found the time. And your TV mother with the cocktail eyes could never really reach your mind. So you fixed your star to a passing dream and took a cocaine holiday. Now the years flow around you in a muddy stream. You need another place to stay. Oh, Carol, I think it's time for running for cover. Believe me, you're everyone's and nobody's lover. You got a one-way ticket for all your yesterdays. Silver ship from the stars, I know you're there. I know you'll understand me, you can take me anywhere. I know you must be there. Well, sometimes it seems impossible that the game could get that rough. But the stage is set, the exit spot, and the makeup won't come off. So you make your bow to the balcony. You light another cigarette, and the lights grow dim as the music starts. And it's easy to forget. Oh, Carol, I think it's time for running for cover. Believe me, you're everyone's and nobody's lover. You got a one-way ticket to all your yesterdays. Reach down, silvery ship from the stars, and know you're there. I know you'll understand me, you can take me anywhere.
Amazingly, I then went through 10 years of gigging and making records without ever having a hit anywhere. I don't know why I stuck at it.
Al Stewart, a child of the bomb, bombs. Next on the special of the week. I'm Robert W. Morgan. I'm Robert W. Morgan with Al Stewart on the special of the week. Like most angry young men during the 60s, Al wrote protest songs. However, unlike most protest singers, his songs worked. According to Al, everybody who heard them protested.
It was really awful. It was absolutely incredible. I wrote a song called Child of the Bomb. I was born a child of the bomb. Sort of, you know, like it was a post-nuclear Holocaust song. I don't know, I must have had a terrible childhood looking back. You know? And I once forced my way into Dick James's office because he'd discovered the Beatles, or so I thought. This is what he told everyone. And he said, yes, what can I help you? And I said, I'm a bomb singer. I mean, I remember saying this, you know what I mean? And he said, what? And I said, I know you don't have a bomb singer on your label, you know what I mean? But, you know, you've got to have a bomb singer. I mean, bomb singers are the coming thing. And he said, well, you know, what is a bomb singer? And I said, well, I write about bombs.
Lucy finds the dressing room and the bar, hangs the clothes up, hopes tonight the contract won't be broken. Well, they kick you around so much when you're not a star, make you play all night just for a pittance or a token. But all these imperfections never bothered her at all. She says it sharpens your perception when your back's against the wall. There's something that enables her to rise above it all, to shrug it off just when it seems to go too far. Hey, 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 I think you almost feel the pain coming on inside. Hey, 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 I think you almost feel it now and you don't know why. You don't know why.
I started off with all these bomb songs and death and hatred and war and destruction and pestilence and plague, and it was totally unlistenable to it. It was really awful stuff. First time I ever played Child of the Bomb in a folk club in London, everyone laughed. They thought it was a comedy. They thought I was doing a skit. It nearly destroyed me. I mean, it nearly wiped me out. I was singing this serious song, and the audience was just slowly breaking up. You know, they were sort of wobbling and laughing And they thought I was sending it up, and in fact I was serious. So that taught me a lesson. I stopped writing bomb songs, and I started writing love songs.
Al's fortunes began improving once he decided to make love, not war. In fact, Love Chronicles, his second album, was named the best folk album of 1969 by England's Melody Maker magazine.
Said, don't you think we're going downhill? And I would hate it to be under the mill. Oh, love me or leave me, but please don't deceive me. For if you do, I'll know. Believe me, I want you to know. I don't want you to go anyway. Yes, I was doing all right up until now. I'm beginning to think you should have listened to us.
Unfortunately, not enough people were listening to Al. But instead of getting hysterical, Al Stewart got historical.
I thought, well, what do I know something about which is really going to be mine and not anyone else's, which I can do without embarrassing myself and the rest of the world, right? And that turned out to be history. They all relate to today. Any of the historical songs which I've written, they're almost never about that period of time. They're almost always relatable to current events and current times.
The fishing boats go out across the evening water, smuggling guns and arms across the Spanish border. The wind whips up the waves aloud, the ghost moon sails among the clouds, turns the rifles in silver on the border. On my wall, the colors of the maps are running. From Africa, the winds, they talk of changes coming. The torches flare up in the night,
the hand that sets the farms alight to spread the word to those waiting on the border. In the village where I grew up, nothing seems the same. Still you never see the change from day to day. No one notices the customs slip away. Late last night the rain was knocking on my window. I moved across the darkened room and in the lamp glow I thought I saw down in the street the spirit of the century, telling us that we're all standing on the border. In the islands where I grew up, nothing seems the same. It's just the patterns that remain, an empty shell. But there's a strangeness in the air you feel too well. Fishing boats go out across the evening water, smuggling guns and arms across the Spanish border. The wind whips up the waves aloud, the ghost moon sails among the clouds, turns the rifles into silver on the border. On the border. On the border.
Al Stewart conducts a songwriter's workshop. Next on the special of the week, I'm Robert W. Morgan. Robert W. Morgan with Al Stewart on the special of the week. His melodies are inspired, the production superb, the guitar and sax solos stunning. These are the trademarks of the Al Stewart sound. But what really sets Al's songs apart from, let's say, the latest disco smash is his lyric writing. The subjects Al chooses to write about are usually mentioned only in the back pages of scholarly quarterlies, not in songs on the radio.
Well, that at least is deliberate. That's like just a compulsion because I get awfully bored with, I don't know, if someone is singing something that is totally, completely meaningless. You know, like, hey, everybody, get together and let's all be brothers and let there be peace and love and man, we can get it together if we just get a little high and baby, you're the one for me because I've been feeling so blue until you came along and you were new and now you do it to me too like I do it to you.
Nothing that's forced can ever be right if it doesn't come naturally, Lisa. That's what you said as you turned out the light and we bent our backs as slaves of the night. She lowered her guard, showed me the scars she got from trying to fight. So no, you better believe it.
That's one school of songwriting. The obverse side of the coin, which I hate just as much, is the purple haze of infinity drifts across the deserted canyons of my hopeless mind, struggling into the infinitesimal minutiae of the scars of the planetary excesses which have ravaged my soul for the centuries of, you know, whatever, right? Now read on, you know? And that's just as bad. Somewhere in between there are the sort of lyrics which I like, you know, which just really sort of convey some kind of a feeling.
You told the man in the Broadway hotel nothing was stranger than being yourself. And he replied with a tear in his eye, love was a roll away, just a cajole away, missed on a summer's day. Nothing was clear, love was a smile away, just a defile away. I sought it every way, no one came near.
Al is a stickler for detail, He read nearly 50 books before writing Roads to Moscow, a song about the Nazi invasion of the Soviet Union. He's so methodical that when he made a slight historical error in Man for All Seasons, he felt his literary license should have been revoked. And what was that mistake?
I don't think I want to tell you. If I tell you, then you'll know about it and the listeners will know about it. I mean, it's a tiny thing. It probably doesn't matter a hoot to anyone, you know. I used a word merely because I liked the sound of the word without fact-checking it. And the word actually is Plantagenet, right? And I confused Henry Plantagenet with Henry Tudor, which I would never do if I was even half awake. But somehow or other it slipped by me because I just loved the sound of the word Plantagenet. I know that Plantagenet is not a word that people are going to use in songs, and I wanted it. I wanted that word.
Henry Plantagenet still looks for someone to bring good news in his hour of doubt, while Thomas More waits in the Tower of London, watching the signs running out, and measures the hours out from here to oblivion in actions that can't be undone. A sailor through darkness, he scans the meridian, uncaught by the first rays of dawn. The man for all seasons is lost beneath the storm.
Singer-songwriters like Al Stewart usually have a fanatical cult following them everywhere. Al's cleverly avoided this fate by keeping his face off the front covers of his albums. Come to think of it, I wonder if the man we've been talking to really is Al Stewart.
I almost never get recognized. Really, I could walk around New York for a week and no one would ever recognize me. Even when I have a record in the top 10, they would still never recognize me. Which is good, you know. I mean, to me, if you're me, it's great. I like to wander around the streets and I like to go to movies and I like to do all this sort of stuff. I mean, ideally, I could make, you know, 5 or 10 hits and yet never have my face known. That would be great. Just to be known as a kind of a disembodied voice, you know, that floats over radio systems and sings songs.
I was making my way through the wasteland. The road into town passes through. I was changing the radio stations with my mind on you. All your friends call you Lily Paloma, but that's not the way that you are. It's too much of a gentle misnomer for a shooting star. But you and me, baby, I saw you there. Straight away I knew there's really no hiding. I tell you right now what we're gonna do. We'll go collecting the days, putting the moments away. You're on my mind like a song on the radio. You're on my mind like a song on the radio.
sometimes it's there in your face. There are times when you just look disdainful of the human race. Ah, but then on the wings of emotion, we circle each other in flight. Till together we roam like the ocean in its very night. It's you and me, baby, I saw you there. Straight away I knew there's really no hiding. I tell you right now what we're gonna do. We'll go collecting the days, putting the moments away. You're on my mind like a song on the radio. You're on my mind like a song on the radio.
Time marches on, and so does Al Stewart. Next on the special of the week, I'm Robert W. Morgan. I'm Robert W. Morgan on the special of the week with Al Stewart. Despite his reputation as an intellectual, he does read books, you know, I'm sure you've noticed that Al's as playful as a child. He may be wiser than his years, but Al's also a man well into his 30s who has no intention of ever growing up.
Absolutely, absolutely. I think there is something in the nature of the artist that the artist never quite grows up, you know, which means that you must, it's vital to me, it seems, to retain this kind of sense of almost naivety and innocence, you know, while at the same time you're bound to get buffeted sufficiently by the world to create a cynical and a defensive side. You should also manage somewhere to keep a totally sort of wide-eyed view as well. I think that the mixing together of the two is very often what produces good writing.
You've been so long on lonely street that you're surely falling into decay. It's time to reconstruct yourself. Time to test the water again. What a sight to see. It's a tragedy that you're wasting away. Look around and tell me, is it really worth the price that you pay? I'm Valentina Way.
I try not to use either subject material or lyrics in song which would annoy me if I heard them on the radio. And I get annoyed by things which are very badly written, which is not to say that I think my stuff is well written. I just try and avoid the most objectionable pitfalls. So hence, you know, you have songs which do have off the beaten track subjects.
Most writers of songs about off-the-beaten-track subjects find themselves off-the-beaten-track as well, playing in cramped coffee houses named after Bob Dylan songs and recording for companies who'd be happy to have their albums bootlegged. Al's avoided this destiny because no matter how weighty his songs may seem, they still convey his wide-eyed innocence and charm. And in so doing, Al's become a pop star, whether he likes it or not.
Well, what I don't feel like is a pop star. It's very strange. I'm sure I would have if it had happened 10 years ago. It took me so long to make a hit. My initial feeling was surprise. My secondary feeling was joy. It was wonderful. And my third feeling, which is the one I have now, was acceptance, you know. So I really don't know what we're going to do now. I guess it doesn't matter in the long run. I mean, it enabled me to pay my bills. We were incredibly in debt when Year of the Cat came out. We owed everyone in the world money. And when that record was released, I was living in an apartment and I had a television set, a bed, and a sheet of foam rubber. And that was exactly what I had, you know. We'd come to America to stay, you know.
got your ticket and your hotel keys and your overnight bag at your feet. Looking down on the tropical trees while the Spanish maids pick up the sheets. Conquistador in search of gold for all the jackdaw reasons. The mighty shadow that's so hard to please and follows wherever you go.
Al's quoted so many different authors during this hour that I figured now it's my turn. Who well lives, long lives. For this age of ours should not be numbered by years, days, and hours. Guillaume de Bartas, my favorite French poet, said that in the 16th century, but it could have just as easily been said by Al Stewart in the 20th. By rooting his songs so firmly in the past, present, and future, Al's traveled beyond time, with music that's both timeless and timely. And if you're still having trouble understanding Al Stewart, Al offers this timely tip.
Well, I just tell everybody, you know, just to practice the bugle, you know, and to keep a clear head and carry a light bulb. Dylan said that. It still sounds like wonderful advice. What I have to say to everyone is thank you for buying the record and keep taking the tablets. That's it.
special of the week on Al Stewart was written and produced by Alan Daniel Goldblatt, associate producer Mary Kilmartin. Our directors were Lee Hansen and Tom Rounds. Our engineers, Stu Jacobs and Scott Campbell. The special of the week is produced and distributed by Watermark Incorporated. Executive producer, Tom Rounds. I'm Robert W. Morgan. Thanks for listening.